Receive our prayer. until they find their rest in you. May we find peace in your service, and in the world to come, see you face to face. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated as we welcome the saints.
So happy.
Because of the hard times, there wasn't enough work, so they fired me. I had no idea how I was going to get by. Bills quickly began piling up. I didn't even know how I was going to survive. Things got so bad that I even ran out of food and had nothing to eat. I scraped up all the money I could find, and I still didn't have enough to buy groceries. But then, out of nowhere, a kind man came and handed me a bag full of food. It was as if an angel came down to help me. small act of kindness made a really big difference in my life. So now that I have a new job, I want to help others too.
Well, that is a sweet story. But there are millions of people out there that are hungry. So again, I hate to break it to you, but you giving away free groceries isn't going to make a difference. Excuse me, are you the one who gave my son groceries?
Hi, yes, I am. Why, is everything okay?
It's more than okay. You see, I was recently let go from work. It's been so hard, I wasn't sure I was going to be able to feed my family. But my son walked in with a bag of groceries that you gave him. And now my family can eat it. So thank you. From the bottom of our hearts, thank you so much.
You're welcome. And actually, take this too. You might need it.
Our first reading this morning is taken from the book of Amos. This is what he showed me. The Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line. with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, see, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass them by. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste. And I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, said to King Jeroboam of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the very center of the house of Israel. The land is not to bear all his words. For thus Amos has said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile away from his land. And Amaziah said to Amos, O seer, go, flee away to the land of Judah, earn your bread there, and prophesy there. But never again prophesy at Bethel, for it is the king's sanctuary, and it is a temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered Amaziah, I am no prophet, nor a prophet's son, but I am a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore trees. And the Lord took me from following the flock, and the Lord said to me, go, prophesy to my people Israel. Now therefore, hear the word of the Lord. You say, do not prophesy against Israel, and do not preach against the house of Isaac. Therefore, thus says the Lord, your wife shall become a prostitute in the city, and your sons and your daughters shall fall by the sword, and your land shall be parceled out by line. You yourself shall die in an unclean land, and Israel shall surely go into exile away from its land. This is the word of the Lord. Our song this morning is Psalm 82. We will say it responsibly. God takes his stand in the council of heaven. He gives judgment in the midst of the gods.
How long will you judge my son and show favor to the wicked?
Save the weak and the orphan. Defend the humble and needy.
Rescue the weak and the poor. Deliver them from the power of the wicked.
They do not know, neither do they understand. They go about in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are shaken.
The mouse is in you are lost, and all your children are the most high. Nevertheless, you shall have immortals, and all the ignorance.
Arise, O God, and rule the earth, for you shall take all nations for your own. And together, strength of the weak, defender of the needy, rescuer of the poor, deliver us from the power of wickedness, that we may rejoice in your justice now and forever. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The second reading is a reading from the letter of Paul to the Colossians. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers and sisters in Christ in Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. In our prayers for you, we will always thank God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus, and of the love that you have for all the saints, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. You have heard of this hope before in the word of the truth, the gospel that has come to you. just as it is bearing fruit and growing in the whole world. So it has been bearing fruit among yourselves from the day you heard it and truly comprehended the grace of God. This you learned from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and he has made known to us your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we heard it, we have not ceased praying for you and asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you may lead lives worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him as you bear fruit in every good work as you grow in the knowledge of God. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Beat him and went away. And a man was going down from Jericho and had fell into the hands of robbers. They stripped him and beat him and went away, leaving him dead, half dead. And now, by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise the Levite, when he came to pass the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan who was traveling came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity, and he went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured out some oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal and brought him to the inn, and taking care of him, the next day he looked up to there now and gave them the innkeeper and said to him, take care of him, and when I come back, I will pay you all you have spent and more than you have spent. When those three, two of those things, was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers, he said, the one who showed him mercy, Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? And Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. Lord Jesus, you came to save us when you found us half dead, but you did put oil and wine over our wounds, and you took us to the inn. You always want your church to keep your people waiting for your return. Help us that we may look with hope that you will come back for us. For this we ask through your name. Amen. So friends, you remember when we talked about Jesus setting his eyes towards Jerusalem. And I said Jerusalem in this story of Luke is not something to be taken as a geographical place, but rather Jerusalem to Luke was the place where Jesus was going to ascend to heaven. So in a sense, Luke, when he talks about Jerusalem, he is talking about the new Jerusalem of God, he is talking about the throne of God. And so I want to continue on that same meaning of Jerusalem, and coming with this story of the Good Samaritan. The Good Samaritan parable has been interpreted in many ways, and it is allowed to do that because a parable is a spiritual story which is used to illustrate a moral or a spiritual lesson. So Jesus would always throw in stories. He was a good storyteller. He would throw in stories in order for people to understand what was hidden, in order for people to get moral lessons, in order for people to understand what God was saying to them. Now, the parable of the Good Samaritan has also been taken as a parable which is more like an allegory as well, in which everything in the story stands for something or represents something. This is the interpretation first proposed in the second century by bishops like Irenaeus and Clement. And there were also other church fathers who took even this interpretation and used them in their teaching. And one of those is John Chrysostom. John Chrysostom is one of the, if we the prayer about the grace, where it says that, oh Lord, you, when two or three are gathered in your name, you promise that you'll be among them. He coined that prayer as well. That's what John Chrysostom is known for. So he's also one of those teachers or church fathers who have taken over the interpretation of this parable of the Good Samaritan as an allegory that everything in the story stands for something or represents something. Now the parable of the Good Samaritan, according to the church fathers, is a parable which talks about Jesus himself. It talks about Jesus. Yes, it may be a story that he threw there, but it talks about him. How does it talk about him? He says, a man was coming from Jerusalem, going to Jericho, and he fell among robbers. And the robbers stripped him naked and left him half dead. Now, a man does not have a name, right? He's just a man. And this man is not given an identity, whether he was Jewish, whether he was Samaritan or anything. He doesn't say that. Now, when you hear about a man, according to the Israelites, a man represents Adam, because the word Adam itself, Hadama, means earth, means man. So when Jesus is saying a man to an Israelite, they would understand. Adam is coming down. Coming down from where? From Jerusalem. Going to Jericho. Now heaven is up in our own interpretation, right? And we come down from heaven. Jerusalem, geographically, is up in Israel. And you come down from Jerusalem. And the Jerusalem is a place of importance. And the Israelites even believe that the closer you get to Jerusalem, the more holier you become. But the further you went away from Jerusalem, the more defiled you are. Right? So this man was coming down from Jerusalem. The same thing that happens with who? With Adam. Adama. Earth. Man. He fell from that position of Jerusalem, from that position of the throne of God. So this talks about the fall of man, because he is coming from a place of significance or importance and going down to a place of no significance if you're talking about spiritual significance. And when that happens, when Adam is no longer in the presence of God, what happens? He is attacked by the devil and his agencies. So he fell among robbers. And that is what happens when we go away from God. And then, when that has happened, what next? A priest was going that way. And also a Levite was going that way. What did they do? They looked, but couldn't help. The law will never help, Jesus would say. The law will never help you. The law will never give you salvation. The priest and the Levite will just look, but they will not be able to understand, to help. What does it take? It takes a Samaritan. He doesn't say it's a good Samaritan. It's our interpretation where we would then say, oh, this Samaritan was good, so then we then give you the title and say, good Samaritan. But it takes a Samaritan who was going that way, intentionally looking for someone to be helped. And he saw this man half dead. And he came to him and helped him. What did he do? He bandaged him. And he used oil and wine on his wounds. Jesus is the Samaritan, coming down from Jerusalem, coming down from heaven towards Jericho, to a man who is half dead, to Adama, to earth, to me and to you. And what does he do? He bandages our wounds using oil. And when we talk about the sacraments of the church, we talk about the unction of the sick. And what do we use? We use oil for them. And when we talk about the sacraments of the church, we talk about Holy Communion, which carries with it medicinal properties. And when we receive Holy Communion, we are strengthened. And when we receive Holy Communion, healing comes to us as well. So he uses those to bandage our wounds, oil and wine. And that's what Jesus does to us. And the next thing he does, he did put the man on his donkey. And he rode to the next inn. And there he got to the inn. And he lodged for this man. And he said to the innkeeper, keep this man. Here are 2 denarii. I'm going away, but I'll come back again. And when I come back again, please give me the bill and I will pay it. But keep this man. What is Jesus doing? He is entrusting the care of his people to the church. The church is the inn. And the innkeeper are those ministers who minister in the church of God. And what are they supposed to do? They are supposed to continue the treatment that Jesus has given to this person, to this man, to this other. And what is that treatment? The church should continue with the sacraments to the people of God, bandaging their wounds with oil and wine. And the church should not confront and look at the patient and say to them, you must pay your bill. No, the innkeeper should not do that, because Christ is going to come back. He says to us, I will pay you when I come back. Many times as workers in the church, as ministers in the church, we want to be compensated handsomely. But we don't owe it to the people. But rather we owe it to Jesus, because he said that he's coming. He will reward us. He will give us what is worthy to us. But we should continue looking after the patient, looking after the man that he has brought to the inn. The church is a place of healing, the place where people are bandaged with their wounds, where oil and wine are applied to their wounds. Are we doing that, you and me, as we work in the church of God? Are we bandaging the wounds? Are we applying wine and oil to the wounds? Or rather, we are afflicting and inflicting more wounds on the people of God. Wine and oil should be used so that the people of God will continue with the healing that was first administered by Jesus when he found them half dead. My dear friends, Jesus asked the question at the end of it all to the lawyer, who of these three was a neighbor? And the lawyer replied and said, the one who did good to him. He did not want to mention that the Samaritan did a good thing, because the Jews detested the Samaritans, because the Samaritans were people of mixed blood. They had Jewish blood in them, but they also had foreign blood in them. And if you read John chapter 4, the encounter of Jesus with that woman in the well, she spelled it out. Jews and Samaritans do not get along. But here, a Samaritan managed to assist a man whom we do not know. The church should understand that Jesus sometimes identifies himself with the people whom we least expect. And so in this story, he chooses to take the side of the Samaritan. In this story, he chooses to become a Samaritan, speaking to the Jews. Jesus is always in this habit of taking the side of the poor, Jesus is always in this habit of taking the side of the despised. And so in this story, he is the Samaritan. Do you have people whom you detest in life, whom you despise, whom you do not like? Sometimes Jesus takes their side and he becomes those people. Sometimes you will pass Jesus without knowing, because he has taken the face of someone whom you do not like. Be a good neighbor, be a neighbor to anyone. It's not a fellow Jew, it's not someone who lives next door to you, it's not someone whom you are in a club with, it's not someone whom you sit on the same board with, but it is anyone made in the image of God. A man is coming down from Jerusalem. Jesus does not give him an identity. He just said, a man, who is you and me. And so that's how we must see everybody. Just a man or just a woman. And when we see that person, let us see God, because they are made in the image of God. Christ Jesus, the Good Samaritan, came for us when we were half dead, and he bandaged us, and he applied oil and wine to our wounds, and he brought us to the inn. Here is the inn. We are in the inn, and we should be taken care of. But as we are in the inn being taken care of, we also need to take care of our fellow patients and also help them in their afflictions. May God bless us. May he make us to be a good community, that we may take care of each other, that we may bandage each other's wounds, that we may apply oil and wine to each other. Amen.
Amen.
Standing, we'll say the Apostles' Creed together. Let us confess the faith of the baptism as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord.
He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born in the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of our Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us prepare ourselves for the prayers of people.
Make us sensitive to all who are in need or trouble, that we may care for the suffering and be generous in our dealings. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you, O Father, and the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end. This morning we pray for our Primate Linda Nichols, the ELCIC National Bishop Susan Johnson, our Diocesan Bishop Jeffrey, the Amos Nautical Bishop Jason, the Interim National Indigenous Bishop Cindy Black, our Metropolitan of the Ecclesiastical Province of Rupert's Land, Greg, the Council of the North, the Bishop of our Companion Diocese, Michael Loboa, and our priest Abel. In the Anglican community worldwide, we pray for the Church of the Province of Uganda. In the Anglican Church in Canada, we pray for Reverend William Cliff, Bishop, and the clergy and people of the Diocese of Brandon, ELCIC Bishop Larry Kokendorfer, the people and rostered ministers of the Synod of Alberta and the Territories. In the ACC and ELCIC, let there be Greeting Assembly 2022, Gathering of Anglicans and Lutherans, the 20th anniversary of Full Communion. In the Diocese of Rupert's Land, we pray for our congregations and communities, and our companion diocese parish of Muse M. Parish, the Reverend Joseph Kitsu, Rector. We give thanks for all who have given us help when we were down, for all who have supported us and protected us. We pray that your church may seek out and recover the fallen, that we may never avoid our responsibility and pass on to the other side. We pray today for the work of the Salvation Army, for city missions, and for the work of the Samaritans. Lord of compassion and love,
deliver us from all evil.
We pray for all who have fallen among thieves, all who are robbed of their possessions or well-being, for people robbed of their livelihood or their health. We remember all who are treated like slave labor, all who are counted as disposable units. We pray especially for any who have been made redundant or homeless. Lord of compassion and love,
deliver us from all evil.
We give thanks for all who look after our well-being, who protect us and seek to supply our needs. We ask you to bless our homes with your love. May they be places of gentleness and grace where all are accepted and cared for. Dear Lord, we pray for all children and seniors in our community. And we especially remember those in Patricia Gardens and Princess Court. In our parish cycle of prayer, we pray for Carol and Paul Keeling, Jessica, Isaac, Lyra, and Hugo Keeling, Kathy and Roy Kirby, Landon and Johnny Crosley and Susan Clemenson, Mike, Lisa, and Sophie Koshaw. We continue to pray for our companion parish of St. Peter's in Kijiji, in the Central Diocese of Central Uganda, and their priest, Reverend Audrey Masika. We pray for homes where there is violence and cruelty, for homes where people live in fear and anxiety. Lord of compassion and love, we give thanks for the work of the emergency services and ask your blessing upon the fire service, ambulance workers, police, and social workers. We pray for all carers and especially for doctors and nurses. We remember all who are down at this time and all near to death, especially if they are lonely and afraid. We pray for friends who are ill. Especially, we pray for those who are sick and for those who have asked us to. Emily Ambridge, Penny Bruval, Haley Shute, Bill Laundry, Brian Reed, Sharon Robinson, Rick Victor, and Queen Elizabeth II. Lord of compassion and love, we pray that when we are close to death, we know that you come to us, O Lord. We give thanks for all you have rescued from the valley of the shadow of death. We remember those of our community and our loved ones who are in the fullness of eternal life. Lord of compassion and love,
deliver us from all evil.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins and be confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in heart, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have not done. We have not done with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways.
confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please stand for the peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another in time of peace. Peace be with you.
Glory to you forever.
On the night before he gave up his life for us, Jesus. Jesus at supper with his friends took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which is given for you." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which is shed for you and for many, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me."
Lord, I need you forever and ever.
Gracious God, with this bread and wine, we celebrate the death and resurrection of Jesus, and we offer ourselves to him. Send your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts, that we may know the presence of Jesus in the breaking of bread and share in the life of the family of your children. Father, you call us to be your servants. Fill us with the courage and love of Jesus, that all the world may gather in joy at the table of your kingdom. We sing your praise, Almighty Father, through Jesus our Lord, in the power of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Glory to you forever and ever. Amen.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
We believe in the hand of our body, for we all share in the one bread.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Christ, the bread of the gift.
May God's grace be upon this shower, warming, comforting, enfolding, and embracing. May it be a safe haven, a sacred place of security and well-being, sustaining and embracing in good times as well as in difficult ones. May the one who received it be cradled in hope, kept in joy, graced with peace and wrapped in love. And bless the Almighty Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. All your works praise you, O Lord, and your faithful servants bless you. Gracious God, we thank you for feeding us for the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. May we who share his body, live his risen life. We who drink his cup, bring life to others. We whom the Spirit guides, give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so that we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth give praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. God, fill your hearts with his love, give you courage to proclaim his kingdom, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you.